on this edition for Sunday, September 13th. Wildfires continue to devastate parts of California and the Pacific Northwest.
The test that we're going to see over the next couple of months, I think, is whether or not Trump can get his base passionate enough so that they turn out in unexpected numbers the way they did 4 years ago.
Jeff Greenfield with the latest in politics.
Should we taste it?
Yeah, you can taste it.
And upcycling, turning food scraps into nutritious snacks. Next on PBS NewsHour Weekend.
PBS NewsHour Weekend is made possible by Sue and Edgar Wackenheim III, the Anderson Family Fund, Bernard and Denise Schwartz, the Cheryl and Philip Milstein family, Barbara Hope Zuckerberg, the Leonard and Norma Chlorfein Foundation, Charles Rosenblum. We try to live in the moment to not miss what's right in front of us. At Mutual of America, we believe taking care of tomorrow can help you make the most of today. Mutual of America Financial Group, retirement services and investments.
For 25 years, Consumer Cellular has been offering no-contract wireless plans designed to help people do more of what they like. Our U.S.-based customer service team can help find a plan that fits you. To learn more, visit consumercellular.tv.
Additional support has been provided by and by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting, a private corporation funded by the American people, and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
Good evening and thanks for joining us. The campaigns for president are closing in on the November 3rd election. And for the next 8 weekends, we are going to track the issues in our Roads to Election 2020 series. Our first stop is in the battleground state of Pennsylvania this weekend, where we are reporting in person. We'll also be visiting states virtually, talking with reporters and voters. We'll have more from Pennsylvania after today's news summary. At least 33 people have now died in the massive wildfires burning from California to Washington state since mid-August. The fires have also brought a smoky haze up and down the West Coast and some of the worst air quality in the world. California is battling 28 major fires spreading across more than 3 million acres. In Oregon, tens of thousands of people have evacuated. More than 600,000 acres have burned in Washington state. South of Portland, Oregon, in Clackamas County, local relief groups set up temporary shelters and provided aid to evacuees. In Jackson County, in southern Oregon, local officials continue to search for missing people and identified the remains of 4 people yesterday who died in a fire there. NewsHour Weekend's Christopher Booker spoke with Oregon Public Broadcasting reporter Emily Curitan earlier today for the latest on the continuing fire crisis.
What is the status of the fires and what is the status of the evacuation?
The danger is not over. Today, 500,000 people in Oregon are under some level of evacuation notice. About 40,000 people have been told to leave their homes, but the majority of those have been told to pack a bag and get ready to go. So this includes communities not far from Portland. And in southern Oregon, we're also braced for a harrowing couple of days. Towns that have already burned are now under a red flag warning again, and there's high winds expected in that part of the state.
A red flag warning because there's an expectation or an anticipation that the fires may return?
Conditions are prime for extreme fire activity.
And while this is happening, there seems to be quite a bit of misinformation or missing information. Tell me about what people know and how people are making decisions.
It's very difficult right now. Yesterday, I spoke with people who had fled the Holiday Farm fire, one of dozens burning throughout the state, and they fled their homes in the middle of the night last week. And here we are 6 days later, and they did not know the extent of damage to their communities or where unaccounted people were, if they were missing, if they had escaped, or if they had been caught in the fires. So that is something that's been really hard for survivors and for responders. And we're also seeing misinformation on social media take the form of rumors. And this has wasted law enforcement resources, specifically Facebook community groups with residents in areas that have been hit by the fires. People are posting things like that Antifa set the fires. OPB spoke with officials. There's absolutely no evidence to support this, but it hasn't stopped people from setting up roadblocks around towns or checking who's coming in and out of some of these burned communities. In fact, one of OPB's own reporters was stopped by armed vigilantes trying to access Malala, Oregon.
The governor has also told the state to brace for a mass casualty event. Has there been any updates about just how many people have died? And if not, has that warning continued?
Yeah, we are braced for a high death toll. The governor of Oregon, Kate Brown, has said this is likely to be the most substantial loss of life and property from fire in the state's history. And again, it's not like the immediate danger is over. So search and rescue efforts have been slowed. Firefighters and emergency responders, they spent this weekend in survival mode and have not yet pivoted to recovery.
The pandemic is still going on. Where are people being sent? Are they outside? Are they in tents? Are they collecting in gyms?
What we're seeing at evacuation points set up around the state is people who have the ability to remain in a vehicle or camp around their vehicle are doing that. And people who absolutely have nowhere else to go or don't have a family to go and see, they're being referred to hotel rooms as they're available. The problem is there just aren't enough available hotel rooms in the immediate area of the evacuated communities.
What is the air quality like currently in Oregon?
It's terrible. The smoke is blanketing the entire state right now and making it hard to breathe. I don't go outside without wearing a respirator right now. And all of Oregon and Washington have unhealthy air. The particulate is so dense, it's considered either very unhealthy to hazardous or even above the levels for hazardous. So it's literally off the charts bad to breathe outside right now.
What are the people you've spoken with who have evacuated? What are they saying to you?
The people I've spoken with in the immediate aftermath of fleeing were just traumatized. I mean, and these are people that live in fire-prone communities. So people have seen this before, and what was different about the firestorm of Monday night was how fast it moved.
What are the next steps?
The next week is going to continue to be an uphill battle for firefighters. President Trump approved an emergency federal declaration Thursday that will supplement state resources. Because keep in mind, Oregon's budget already took a major hit from revenue loss due to the pandemic. And the state already has a pretty notorious housing shortage. So this makes everything really uncertain now, especially for people who lost their rentals and mobile homes. We know at this point that those mobile homes along rivers have been decimated. On the optimistic side of things, the weather this weekend did improve and the wildfires grew more slowly. Oregon Governor Kate Brown has said, we still have a long way to go though, and that some large fires that have merged to create mega fires are likely to burn until we get fall rain.
Emily Curitan from OPB, thank you so much for joining us.
You're very welcome.
President Trump thanked firefighters battling the wildfires in the West at a Nevada rally last night. He also used the event to attack mail-in balloting, his opponent, former Vice President Joe Biden, and did not mention climate change as a factor in the recent fires, instead repeating his opinion that the cause has to do with what he calls forest management.
They really haven't. They never had anything like this. But, you know, it is about forest management. Please remember the words. Very simple. Forest management, please remember.
The president addressed a mostly maskless crowd at the late night event at an airport in Minden, Nevada, south of Reno. A plan to hold the rally in Reno was rearranged when officials said it would violate a COVID-19 restriction that limits gatherings to fewer than 50 people. The president will go to California for a briefing on the fires tomorrow after meetings with supporters and a speech in Henderson, Nevada tonight. Police in Los Angeles are searching for a suspect who ambushed and shot two sheriff's deputies in their patrol car last night. Surveillance video of the shooting near the Metro Blue Line station in Compton shows what appears to be a man walking up to the passenger side of the vehicle and firing several times. The suspect then ran off on foot. The two deputies survived, but sustained multiple gunshot wounds and are reportedly in critical condition. Both have been on the job for just over a year. Tropical Storm Sally is projected to cross the Gulf of Mexico tomorrow and may become a hurricane by the time it makes landfall. New Orleans and the Gulf Coast from Grand Isle, Louisiana to the Alabama-Florida line are under a hurricane watch. Sally brought heavy rain and strong winds as it crossed South Florida, and Louisiana Governor John Bel Edwards declared a state of emergency late yesterday. Sally is the earliest an S-named storm has ever formed in the Atlantic tropical season, according to the National Hurricane Center. This afternoon, New Orleans officials issued mandatory evacuation orders for all of St. Charles Parish and warned residents to expect power outages. Sally is expected to slow down as it reaches the Gulf Coast and could be a Category 2 storm at landfall. In Belarus today, mass anti-government protests continued for a 36th consecutive day following the country's disputed presidential vote last month. More than 100,000 people marched in the country's capital of Minsk, calling for the resignation of President Alexander Lukashenko, who has been in power for 26 years. Protesters are also demanding the release of jailed opposition leaders after the August 9th elections, which the opposition says were rigged. Local elections are taking place in dozens of regions across Russia today in what Kremlin critics say is a big test for the ruling United Russia Party, which backs President Vladimir Putin. The vote follows the suspected poisoning of opposition leader Alexei Navalny last month after he left the city of Tomsk. Navalny is now in a hospital in Germany. Opposition groups allege widespread corruption among United Russia deputies. Many opposition supporters are implementing a smart voting strategy aimed at identifying candidates most likely to beat the ruling party candidates. Today's vote will elect 18 governors and an array of local members of parliament and city councils. For the latest national and international news, visit pbs.org/newshour. Pennsylvania is one of the so-called battleground states where polls show voter split almost evenly between the two parties and where a tiny margin of victory in the popular vote can mean an electoral college win in the race for president. For more on what's developing in the final weeks of the campaign, recently I spoke with special correspondent Jeff Greenfield, who joins us from Santa Barbara, California. Jeff, it's the season when people see stories about polls, that Biden is up in one poll by 8 points, and then Biden is dead even in another poll. Are they measuring the same thing, the same electorate? How is it possible?
Basically, there are a whole bunch of assumptions that any pollster would make. Do I have the right mix? Do I have enough college-educated whites? Do I have enough rural folks? Do I have enough people of color? The other thing is that they're basically guessing also about who's likely to vote, because if they're not talking to people who are voting, or if people talk to them and give them their preference and it turns out they don't vote, then the poll is really of no predictive value, assuming you think polls have predictive value anyway. So it's really not that much of a mystery. It's just that every pollster has a different set of assumptions about whether they've got the sample right, which is why Biden can be up by 5 points nationally in one poll and 12 in another.
So is there any kind of a real clear picture?
Here's my advice. Take the average. And the average basically tells you that Biden's up nationally by about 7.5 points. I should mention, on March 20th, Biden was up by about 7.5 points. So if you had gone into hibernation on March 20th and awakened yesterday, you would have assumed nothing happened, not a pandemic, not the George Floyd killing, not the economic collapse. It's really astonishing how unmoving that national number is. And as we all learned last time, Harry, how that national number doesn't necessarily tell you the significant thing.
Right. So when we go look at the state by state picture, what do we learn? I mean, what did we learn last time?
Last time the state polls were in Wisconsin and Pennsylvania particularly were way off. The national poll was kind of right. They had Clinton winning by about 2 or 3 points nationally, and she did. And pollsters have been scratching their heads about how they got this so wrong. One of the explanations is they did not measure the intensity of support for Trump and the antipathy toward Hillary Clinton among rural voters. That kind of mistake about who you're talking to or the assumption about what people will do is partly what made those numbers wrong. The other theory is that Trump voters are less likely to respond to pollsters' phone calls or online questions than others, and there is something to that.
How is that possible, that the racial reckoning post-George Floyd, the pandemic, the economic catastrophe that so many people find themselves in that are not participating in the upside of the stock market, how does that not have an effect?
We've seen this now, I think, for 5 years. And Trump was very candid years ago when he said to Leslie Stahl, I attack the press so that when my voters hear negative stories, they don't believe them. And so I think what's happened is nothing has moved the Trump base, but Trump has been unable to expand that base. That's why the numbers are so consistent. He's the first president in recorded memory never to have hit 50% in approval. And the test that we're going to see over the next couple of months, I think, is whether or not Trump can can get his base passionate enough so that they turn out in unexpected numbers the way they did 4 years ago, and once again render the pre-election polls wrong. And I need to say one other quick thing about this whole business about predicting, which is that people don't seem to get that when someone like Nate Silver, the guru, says that Biden has a 3-to-1 chance in winning, that's not a prediction. That's a probability estimate. If you ran this campaign 100 times, Biden would win 70. These numbers don't tell you with any kind of certainty what they seem to tell you. I'm suggesting everybody try the decaf, take a deep breath. We'll know in 7 weeks or so.
All right. Jeff Greenfield joining us from Santa Barbara, California. Thanks so much.
Good to see you, Mark.
One issue both presidential candidates face is the growing problem of food waste, which contributes to pollution and greenhouse gases. There have been several efforts, both globally and nationally, to tackle that challenge. But one new technique is gaining momentum. It's called upcycling. Researchers at Drexel University in Philadelphia, about 60 miles from here, have been producing upcycled products, creating new categories of food from discarded ingredients. NewsHour Weekend special correspondent Allison Aubrey and producer Mary Beth Durkin have the final report from their five-part series, Waste Not, Want Not.
Should we taste it?
Yeah, you can taste it.
That white, doughy substance that Caitlin Majental and Claire Schlemmy are tasting is okara. It's a pulpy protein that's left over after you make tofu.
Oh, it's getting wet.
They're at Hodo, an organic tofu manufacturer in Oakland, California. Schlemmy is the CEO of a food startup called Renewal Mill, just blocks away. Renewal Mill pays Hodo to dry out the okara into strips like this. Then it's milled into a flour that Renewal Mill sells. Caitlin Majental is one of Schlemmy's customers, and she's here to see how it's done. Majental is CEO of her own startup called Pulp Pantry. It's located in Los Angeles. Renewal Mill's flour is an ingredient in a new line of chips that Majental's company makes. They're called pulp chips.
Why would somebody want to eat snacks with okara in it?
So it's full of nutrition. It's about two-thirds fiber and one-third protein. So it's kind of like a pile of like delicious nutrition right here.
Min Sai owns Hodo. It's the third largest tofu manufacturer in the U.S. Min says all this okara is typically discarded by most U.S. manufacturers.
So you're telling me the most nutritious part of the plant usually just gets tossed away?
Absolutely. One of the most nutritious part of the plant. And we know fiber is really important. It's actually not fully utilized.
In Vietnam, Min Sai grew up eating okara. There, they use it to make vegetable pancakes.
We're doing what we already do in Asia because it's really for human consumption in Asia. But here, we don't think about it the same way.
Majental and Schlemmy are part of a new wave of entrepreneurs who are thinking that way. They're taking ingredients once considered to be the dregs and transforming them into whole new products. It's called upcycling.
This is even just a sliver of all those fibrous byproducts that come out of food manufacturing every year in the U.S. and beyond. And so it seemed like a tremendous opportunity.
An opportunity because many manufacturers are happy to get rid of their waste. It saves them the hauling fees to throw it out. And Majental's chips have another upcycled ingredient.
What do we have here?
So it looks like we have apple, we've got some kale in there, we got some celery stalks.
It's leftover pulp from cold pressed juice companies, and Majental mixes that in with the okara to make these chips.
How much of the volume of a piece of produce is really just the pulp?
It can be anywhere from 15 to 50% pulp.
In some cities, there are juice bars on almost every corner. And that adds up to a lot of pulp.
We've worked with juiceries that process millions of pounds of pulp a year, and some juiceries that process solely carrots and might produce 80,000 pounds of pulp a day. A lot of people struggle to find the end use for it.
And that struggle plays out throughout the food industry. But it's a struggle that can translate into profits for upcycling startups.
One company, Barnana, is now a multi-million dollar company that upcycles damaged bananas into snacks called Banana Bites. Another, Treasure 8, is a startup with a patented dehydrating process. They rescue and repurpose damaged produce by dehydrating the produce and making products like beet chips and apple chips.
And these companies have plenty of ingredients to work with. A report by the Natural Resources Defense Council finds 40% of all the food that's grown never makes it to our plates. It estimates that about 125 billion pounds of food gets tossed out each year. And when food ends up in a landfill, it emits a potent greenhouse gas, methane, which contributes to climate change. The United Nations Climate Change Panel concluded that wasted food is responsible for up to 10% of all human-induced greenhouse gases globally.
The more that we can keep food out of landfills and put it back into feeding people, the more that not only we can address issues like the efficiency of our food system and making sure that all of those resources that go into growing our food are actually preserved to their purpose, which is feeding people.
And these upcycling companies hope to win over customers and make a profit by telling their stories.
Kat, tell us about yours and what's in it, and then also how the upcycle broth performed.
Jonathan Deutsch runs the food lab at Drexel University's Food and Hospitality Department in Philadelphia. He's conducted several studies on consumer attitudes towards upcycled products.
Consumers are willing to pay more if they know that this product is upcycled, if it's good for the environment, if there's good messaging. They don't need to know that they had the most beautiful pale pink grocery store tomatoes in their tomato sauce. They don't mind knowing that these were split and burst and overripe. That could and should be part of the story.
Deutsch started the food lab back in 2014. It's become a go-to hub for food innovation. And these days, the focus is on upcycled products.
We're working with medium-sized companies in that, you know, $10 to $150 million of sales range. They're not doing a lot of innovation in their own systems, and so have been asking us to help with new product ideas, ways to divert waste into products.
Deutsch says it's not just startups interested in upcycling.
We've seen a big increase in multinationals who have been interested in upcycling, in greening their own practices. Think of things like Lunchables, right? Things you could like stack, put together.
In class, Deutsch challenges his students to come up with new ways to use upcycled ingredients and create new products. Today, Kat Andres is working with the concentrated soup broth that Deutsch helped a company called Matriarch develop. It's made from discarded vegetable bits that the company buys from distributors. Another student, Anna Wilson, is working with flour made from sunflower seed shells. The flour has a nutty flavor and is a good source of protein. She hopes to perfect a crunchy biscuit out of it.
We're using for selective eaters, children on the autism spectrum who prefer crunchy, crispy things, often don't get enough protein, because if you think about protein, meat and dairy and tofu and beans and peanut butter, a lot of protein sources are mushy.
According to Deutsch, upcycling is here to stay. He's working with a group called the Upcycling Food Association to conduct focus groups. One goal is to determine which symbols may work best to label these products and make them stand out as upcycled.
Within a few years, upcycled won't be this quirky little corner of the food world, but you'll see a major cereal box or potato chip or pasta sauce manufacturer with a little upcycled logo, and it will be just as normal as seeing an organic logo.
One study estimates that upcycled foods now make up a $46 billion market in the U.S., and industry experts expect it to continue to grow.
But despite Deutsch's optimism, upcycling startups, like everyone else, face uncertain economic times ahead.
That's all for this edition of PBS NewsHour Weekend. For the latest news updates, visit pbs.org/newshour. I'm Hari Sreenivasan. Thanks for watching. Stay healthy and have a good night.
PBS NewsHour Weekend is made possible by Sue and Edgar Wackenheim III, the Anderson Family Fund, Bernard and Denise Schwartz, the Cheryl and Philip Milstein Family, Barbara Hope Zuckerberg, the Leonard and Norma Chlorfine Foundation, Charles Rosenblum. We try to live in the moment to not miss what's right in front of us. At Mutual of America, we believe taking care of tomorrow can help you make the most of today. Mutual of America Financial Group, retirement services and investments. Additional support has been provided by Consumer Cellular and by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting, a private corporation funded by the American people. And by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.